Recording is in progress, Billie Rae. So,
yay!
It's finally on. This is my first time I've used my glasses too. So you see my little light in my eyes. I'm like,
well, I'm blurry. I'm kind of like a ghost. So we're
a ghost.
Yes.
Well, the wonders of technology. You're still in the same room as me right now. At least virtually, we are. So that's really cool. So hello, Billie Rae Busby. How are you doing today?
I'm really good. I'm doing really well, Rob. Thank you.
It's so good. Fun to be here. Good. I'm so glad to have you. As I mentioned, yeah, you're on my list of people I really want to talk to over this, but we're cheating. We're cheating. We actually ran into each other just a month and a half ago. Well, didn't run into each other. We met up, right? So
exactly. It was good to see you after many years. And thank you for being a patron of my artwork.
That's right. That's right. So for people who can see this on YouTube, Billie Rae is the artist who produced this lovely little picture right there. Isn't that nice, everyone? How cool is that?
It looks great there, Rob.
I had this spot on my wall. I was like, you know what? I'm going to get a piece of Billie Rae's art. I'm going to wait for one that speaks to me. I'm going to get that thing and put it on my wall. So it's going to be my little backdrop for my podcast. So, but my chair is so short. So actually it seems like it's high up, but it's not. It's not
my office chair. That looks
great. It's so low. So, and I got two pieces. My other piece is actually my uncle Carl, passed away just a few years ago. He was one of those guys. He was just a great painter.
That's great.
And he just made little pieces of art.
A barn. Is that a barn?
It is. Okay. I think my other uncle on my other side of the family took this photo and Uncle Carl saw it and he painted a picture around it, but colorized it and looked somewhere, I think, I'm not sure, between here and Manitoba somewhere. So
that's fantastic.
I just love original art. And that was from our house that it burned down just before COVID. So I was able to take it. That Christmas before that, I was like, you know what? I want to take that with me to Saskatoon. It's in our basement. I just love that painting. And I was like, you know what? I'm taking it back to here. And then once I had it in my little office here, I was like, I got to fill it up with more original art. That's what I got to do. And it's kind of nice being at that stage in my life where I can afford, you know, original paintings and not just buying posters from Place Royale.
I know. I guess I feel like, and that's what's exciting is I do have a lot of friends and people I've known over the years that they are at that place. And not just financially, it's also from a investment in their space and their home. Because I did those Imaginist posters, the IKEA posters, you know, and then you upgrade to HomeSense. And then you find that I think the more adulting we do, you want to really be unique. And that's where original art is an easy way to be able to do that is you can kind of show off your taste and what your interests are. And then also, you know, that you're actually supporting a real person, not maybe, you know, something mass produced over wherever.
That's right. Yeah, for sure. And absolutely, it's good to support like good original art, and it doesn't have to be too complex or to be whatever taste you want to do. You find something that you like and just invest in them. Like you said, invest in space. I like that you use that phrase. That's so smart. Because that's what it is, right?
Yeah, it is. It's where we, you know, most people by the time they've been out of school for a little while, they've either got a condo or even an apartment they love or a house. And they want to make sure that it feels a little bit more special. And for a while there, the show homes were very neutral. And I think it's starting to get back to now where people want to show a little bit more character in what they own. And they're okay with maybe not disposable things anymore. That's also something I've noticed over the pandemic is that people want real things and not just the cheap things that you can buy. They want something that's going to last.
Yeah, that's such a good point. Yeah, for sure. And this is something like, you know, whatever happens, we'll maybe move or whatever happens. I'll always take this with me now. It's so nice to have that little piece, you know, both these little pieces I can just sort of be careful, wrap them up very carefully and move them to my new home wherever I go down the road. Hopefully not too soon, but
They're also conversation pieces too, just like the story you tell me about your uncle. You can now tell people a little story about me, and so it makes it a little bit fun that you can have a conversation about your pieces too, not just oh, I liked the colors, or oh, it was Bob Marley.
Nothing wrong with Bob Marley posters. No, Bob Marley, you know, we're not snobs here. That's for sure.
No, we had those too. So
yeah. Well, I was always big at supporting local music artists, right? So if I have a buddy that has a band, I'll buy their album, like no problem, because I like them and support them. And especially if I like their music, I'll really promote it. I've always done that sort of thing too. So yeah, I don't know as many artists though, like sort of visual type artists as well. So maybe I do and haven't really been tracking them down. Maybe that's the other part of it. I got to start doing that more.
That's possible.
Billie Rae, you're living in Calgary right now. You moved there probably right out of university, I take it, more or less?
I moved out in 99. I graduated in 98 from University of Saskatchewan and moved. I stayed for a year and worked at the community radio station in Saskatoon for a year and then moved out to Calgary. I ended up getting a job at a weekly entertainment publication out here in Calgary doing advertising sales. So I moved out here pretty quick in 99 and got to know the city, and I've fallen in love with it. This has been home for a long time now.
Heater's going off here. Well, that's really cool. I should actually mention to people here, for those of you that don't know Billie and I, we live in a res together at the University of Saskatchewan residence. We met, well, I moved there in 94 and we were friends. You're one of the first girls I met. I would say that at least the first dozen or so, at least half dozen of people in Athabasca Hall, I would have met, I think. So,
yes.
So yeah. Really early on, hanging out at the Pat and...
Yes. Yep. And all the res parties, yes, there was several of those. I took kinesiology. I was in the phys ed department.
Yeah.
And I was also taking art classes along the way too, but I focused my time on getting into sport management and just took art classes because I love them. Everybody assumed when I graduated high school, I'm from Yorkton, Saskatchewan, they assumed I was going to go into the arts because I won the art award and I was kind of the art nerd in high school. And everyone assumed that. And I was like, no, I'm going into sports, like complete opposite worlds. And the great thing about it, though, is I took both. I did kinesiology and I also took art classes. So I had kind of both worlds. And then I had my res friends. So I loved U of S because I had, you know, that cluster of res friends, which were in all different areas of study. And then I had my phys ed friends, my kinesiology friends, and then my jock friends, if you want to, you know, put them in a category. And then I had my art friends. So it was really, really fun.
Yeah, you did have a good group there. Yeah. Well, yeah, that's just thought of it now. But yeah, I know you through Scotty Alberts. That's how I know you.
Penny,
that's how I know.
From Yorkton.
You went to high school in Yorkton. Scott was one of my best friends in res. I miss that guy. I haven't seen him forever. But yeah, that's how I would have known.
Well, hi, Scott, if you see this.
I'm going to send you I doubt he's watching. Maybe he is. I don't know. Penny might be watching. Yeah, Penny's
on. Penny and I connected about my art one time a while ago. So hi, Penny, if you see this.
Penny, I miss you too. You are a lovely lady and I miss you lots. So next time you're in Saskatoon, give me a ring.
Did you know, fun fact about Penny Neal, who we knew from Russ, she was the valedictorian at my high school when I graduated. So.
Well, I don't doubt that. She's a pretty talented person. She's a nuclear engineer now, of all things, if you can believe that. So she's pretty... we were an engineer together, but she kind of went a little bit further than I did. So
that's amazing.
Yeah, no, that's pretty cool. Yeah, so yeah, but yeah, for me, I didn't know you as an art nerd. I thought you were a kinesiology nerd initially when I knew it, because that's all I knew you from, was you were just one of those kinesiology students, which is fine. Well, you're a res student, that's what you were.
Exactly.
Except somebody invited me, it might have been you, but somebody invited me to one of your shows with the art group one time. And I was like, holy cow, I had no idea that A, this even existed on our campus, and B, that you were part of that little crew.
I think that's pretty sweet. I kept it separate a bit too. And I remember it wasn't really until kind of my later that year that I realized that I really enjoyed the U of S arts program because I was just taking the art classes as electives, but I also felt like I could learn a lot and fit in with them. And at the time I specialized in drawing. That was kind of my area. I really wasn't into painting then.
Yeah.
But I also remember that one of our other buddies, Tyler Rittinger, Tyler had a really large space. And I remember saying that I was going to bring my easel over there because he had one of the biggest rooms in all of residence.
Yeah. Yeah. As a single room. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, exactly. So there's a lot of kind of connections, but I also kept my art interest sort of just as my side passion and my hobby and focus that I thought my career was going to go into the kinesiology side.
Yeah. What do you know when you're 18? You're an idiot.
Yes,
you know?
Exactly. Well, my first year of U of S, I didn't even go to Saskatoon. I stayed in Yorkton and I took economics my first year because they had sort of an extended study classes where they had instructors come down to Yorkton. They were instructors, yeah. But they came down. And so my first year, I went into economics, which funny reason, I'm not totally embarrass myself, but I know podcasts are supposed to be about fun facts, is many years later, I tried to think about why I went into economics that first year. And my friend Lorianne also was interested in economics. And we finally realized it was because of Alex P. Keaton from Family Ties that he was into economics. And that's why we thought economics would be cool. Of course, I learned better after a year of taking economics that wasn't really my jam. I have learned a lot and enjoyed that for that time. But I think I was influenced by earlier pop culture that economics was something to be interested in.
Yeah, you don't really strike me as a Reagan Republican. Sport. The Alex.
So I only did that the 1 year.
Well, that's cool. Well, it gets you an intro. That's actually not a bad idea to do that. It gives you sort of a sampling of the university without having to go into it, because I went into it pretty hard. 18 years old, and it's just a gong show. And that was... It's very difficult to describe what Res is to people who've never been there, and I don't think it'll ever be that way again. It's just how wild and free it was and crazy. Well, you know,
I worked at SAIT for many years, which is a post-secondary out here in Calgary, and it's known for having a lot of great trade programs and business, and they have a really beautiful residence. However, it's very opposite of what we were part of, because it's like mini apartments. They've got their own bathroom. They've got a little mini kitchen. You don't even have to interact with your neighbors at all. Whereas it was crucial in our residence, for anybody who's never been in at University of Saskatchewan, you shared a bathroom, you shared a kitchen. Most of the time, most of us didn't cook anyway, but you went to the cafeterias together. And it was very communal that way.
Yeah.
And you knew everybody. Like, it just kind of, unless, even if you were in quiet hall and didn't like to interact, you still got to meet people at the cafeteria or just in the hallways because you were using the same space. So it was a very different experience than a lot of residences that I know on other campuses.
Yeah, I think we're pretty fortunate. Well, A, to survive it, and then secondly, have benefited from it too.
But question for you, Rob: Would you let your children stay in residence when they go out to university?
Well, it's not what it was, for one thing. Although I kind of wish it was, because I don't know. It was great. It was safe. There was no. One thing I liked about this. So when I got involved in my student politics days. Later, I got to do some student conferences. And I remember at a national student conference, guys from Toronto and Montreal, they would, like McGill, they would talk about how there's class structures. And that was one of the struggles they had. It was sort of a class segregation at these universities, rich kids versus poor kids, and a lot of separation between people. And I was like, I live in Riz. I never saw that at all. And there's a few people I found out later who were really, really, like, they came from wealthy families. You never have known it.
No, I wouldn't. I agree with you. Anything like that was not at all.
We're all
maybe you knew it there from a small town. Maybe that was about it. Who was from the smallest communities you've ever heard of? That was probably the only sort of thing we would know about each other. But there was never any judgment. I never remember any of that.
Yeah, it was very. It was a lot of brotherhood, and the rivalries were for petty, stupid things like over girls or you know, rec hockey games or something stupid like that. Like that, that's, or, you know, personalities, which is, that's the way it should be. So would I let him go there? Yes. Yes, I would. In a heartbeat. Like I went to Notre Dame College. And my experience there, I would never let him go there. The experience when I went there, it was very difficult to be. That was a very tough, tough time. Tough school, very tough culture to get into. Like if you didn't fit in, it was tough. And whereas I never found that, there was no, we're all adults for one thing. Yeah. You know, high school is a little different. Like if you're a 15-year-old kid compared to an 18-year-old kid, like that's a big difference, right? Because an 18-year-old is a man and you're like a boy. But by the time you're 18, 19, 20, it's like, Nobody cares anymore, right? And I remember, what's his name? Dan. He lived in our dorm our first year. I forget his last name. Dan the man. He was 22.
Oh, yes. I forgot about that guy.
The girls love him because he's an engineer, really smart, really well, really fit guy. He's a really nice guy. We called him Dan. Old man Dan. Hey, like, old man Dan. Like, he's just so old because he was 22 living in Res. Whatever happened to that guy? He was a good guy. But anyways, yeah. So would you let your kids stay in Res? I don't know. It'd be different for girls.
I think I would. I would just probably want to know a little bit more. But again, things would be very different. There's different how setups would be. And I think there would probably be. No, I think I would. I think I would. And I would probably prefer to send them to the type of Res that we had over the example that I gave you about how the state one is with it being its apartment, because I was never homesick. I missed my parents sometimes for sure, but I was not homesick. Like I felt like there was enough people to keep me company. And I maybe got a little claustrophobic in the small, when I lived the second year on my own, it was a very small room, but I never felt homesick. And I think that that is something that says really wonderful things about the people that I was able to meet during that time.
Yeah. I should also mention too, Connie Kirk, if you remember her, Connie Kirk Herman now, she worked at Res as an advisor, not an RA, but sort of a counselor, basically. They didn't have that position there. So
really? Okay.
Yeah, she did that for a few years and said, yeah, it's changed. Like she did that like more than 10 years ago, but she said, yeah, it's changed. It's probably because it was pretty wild. It was pretty wild at that time. So
lots of pranks too. Lots of pranks.
Leaners. You ever do leaners? Take those big garbage cans, fill them with water, put them against the door, and just walk away. Even leave them there all night. And sometimes if you really want to get the guy, you take not the small garbage cans, but the big giant garbage cans, fill them up with water, lean them against the door. And your room was a mess after. And those carpets, really, really old, very rarely cleaned. It stunk. So basically, learn right away. Like you have to dry that stuff out as soon as you can, or else that it's not going to smell good at all. I got caught a few times. Although the worst ones, they leave the door partially open and all the guys are sitting there and watching you and you walk in. Like they caught me. Well, Dispo caught me one time. I look in and Dispo pushed a door and it's like, I just pushed a door and just garbage can fell down full of water.
Oh no.
If they would have just moved so I didn't see them, I would have been caught for sure. But that was pretty funny. Well, we have a lot of Res stories. I'm sure we can probably tell all night long. And we're going to kind of move on from that.
Sure, that's okay. That's okay. Hi to anybody who is back from this. You've best days, though.
We should start a little Res Facebook group. I thought about doing that for a while. Call like mid-90s VPRA and just do that. That might be nice. Anyways, yeah. So anyways, you're... I'm going to get back to your art because you are an artist now. You always were, but you're a full-time artist now. You said you focused more of your work on drawing at that time and that sort of thing. Or do you want to talk about maybe chronologically where you were? Because you mentioned, again, you moved to Calgary and started your communications career, really, is what it was.
Yeah, exactly. So I'll kind of step back where I talked about high school, where I was a bit of the art nerd and I, growing up in Yorkton, Saskatchewan, Yorkton's about 18,000 people, very hockey focused community, you know, farming, but so really great place to grow up, but really the, one of the things that you would do when you go there, either you loved hockey or you hated it. I played it a bit, but not competitively or anything. But you'd go to the hockey games. So I was big into hockey. And in high school, I started drawing pictures of hockey players because what does a 15 or 16-year-old have interest, female have interest in?
I did too, just so you know.
Okay. So what does a young Rob have interest in too? So and also I collected sports cards with my dad, you know, so I was just into all of sports. And I was known for kind of more realism. So it was using pencil crayons and drawing, and that was what I was into. And then when, as I had mentioned, I decided not to go the art route initially, when I went to university. So I did economics the first year, then I moved into kinesiology because I love sport. It was the U of S was one of the only schools that had a sport management program. So it wasn't going into being a phys ed teacher. It wasn't going into being an athletic therapist. Those were options, but it was one of the only few schools where you could learn about sport management and work for a not-for-profit or a pro team and really understand that side. So that was the area that I took. And it was actually half phys ed kind of kinesiology classes. And the other half was commerce classes, so business classes. So it's a really cool hybrid. There is a really small amount of us, I think 20 of us in our graduating class in that sport management group. So I took that, loved it. And I also took art classes all along the way as my electives. And I found that in my last year of university, if I stayed an extra year and a half, I could also get an art degree too. So I ended up graduating after 5 years with 2 degrees. So again, that kind of fun of having both of those things on my plate of having the sports friends and also then having the art friends. I stayed in Saskatoon for a year, worked in advertising, then moved out to Calgary and was out here working for a publication for a couple of years. Lots of fun getting to know people. I made some of my best friends. Actually, I just had dinner with one of my friends on Friday she was my first friend I met in Calgary. So just a really great opportunity.
What was the publication, Billie?
It was called Fast Forward
Maybe. I love Fast Forward. I got it every week. It was awesome. It had all the bands and what was up. It was awesome. Yeah. No,
I
love
Fast Forward. It was a free weekly. Yeah, it was great. And I did advertising there for a couple of years. And it was by far the best way to get to know Calgary because I was in charge of getting to know business.
Oh,
we lost. And the job was to go out to events and new places. Oh, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Our job was to go out to different places and you know, a new restaurant opens. We were supposed to go there. It was really great. Some of my best friends that I have here now are still from that time. And then I moved into the sports side. I worked for the Calgary Soccer Center. I did, it's a huge indoor structure here where they have a ton of indoor fields and also some outdoor fields. So I did marketing for that for a couple of years. Then I moved on to the Calgary Roughnecks pro lacrosse team. So any of you might know the Calgary or Saskatchewan Rush or Saskatoon. Is it Saskatoon Rush?
Saskatchewan Rush. Three-time champions. Yeah. So
they were Edmonton when I was working for the Roughnecks.
Were you there when you won the title in 2004, I think it was, or was that after you were there? Because I was at that game.
Yeah.
Oh, that was
good. I was at that game too. I didn't start until they won in the spring in 2004, the Roughnecks did, and I started that fall. Okay. So I was there right after, and I enjoyed 3 seasons with them. That was an absolute blast. It was a small, this was when it was privately owned.
Right.
Before the Calgary Flames ownership took them over. Mm-hmm. And so it was about 5 of us, full-time staff, and we did everything. I have so many funny stories. If we ever want to talk about fun sports stuff, I have hilarious stories about working at Roughnecks. And so that was a great time. I was director of ticket operations at that time, and we were averaging about 12,000 people a game. So it was a really busy but fun time to be working in sports. And lacrosse was kind of new. Pro lacrosse was still getting interest, and there's diehards from the beginning and some of the most hilarious and loyal fans you could ever imagine in lacrosse fans. So that was a great time. Then I moved on after that to State where I worked with State Trojan Athletics for just over 12 years. And I was in charge of marketing, communications, media relations. I did fundraising, community outreach, you kind of name it. My job pivoted whatever was interesting, social media, like it kind of changed. And I love that we had several teams there, won many championships with the different teams. And that was a very different than the pro sports. The pro sports was just like you'd expect. It's about ticket sales and it's about the championships. Whereas working at State, it was still for sure the medals, but it was really about making sure that the student athletes graduated, they had a great career in the end, you know, lots of character, really trying to get their philanthropy side out, where they were being charitable and volunteering and helping out. So that was a very different shift for me. And I quite enjoyed it though. It was good to get to know the students. It kept me young. I say that it felt young to be around a bunch of, you know, the 18-year-olds would be there and I'd pretend that my age didn't change very often. So that was a lot of fun. And last year I left State just for during the pandemic. It was time for a change and it was time for me to take my art career to a next level. I had been painting since about 2007. So all those times, those other major jobs I told you about, I kind of stopped painting for a while. I kind of stopped drawing. I just did crafty things because I was busy. I was enjoying a new city. I was married and just, you know, kind of finding a new life. And I didn't really have art as a focus. Then I started taking it back in around 2007. I started to really find that I loved painting and I found this style, which is called hard edge landscape, and been doing that ever since. It was my side thing, my kind of weekend hustle, if you want to call it. And during the pandemic, through all the changes we were all going through, kind of some, you know, life is short, existential things maybe I was happening, I thought, you know what, it's time for me to try this, be an entrepreneur, become a full-time artist and really give this a shot. I didn't want to wait till I was 65 to do it. So here I am. And it's almost a year. It's almost a year now that I've been doing art full-time.
Full-time artist. Yeah. Hard edge landscaping. That's the name of the medium, I guess. Or I don't know the word.
Yes, exactly.
Genre? Yeah. Medium?
Yes. You got it wrong.
I don't know anything about art. Well, I do know a little bit about art, though. But so what attracted you to the sort of the hard edge landscape type molding? When did you fall into that, or how did your art evolve?
Sure. Well, first off, I kind of grew out of the appeal of drawing hockey players. That sort of went away after a while. That was kind of... So that was okay. And I kind of two steps with this. So the first one is I started taking evening classes at ACAD, so Alberta College of Art and Design. It's now changed to Alberta University of the Arts. But I was taking some night classes in about 2004, 2005, just trying to get back. I knew the drawing really wasn't interesting me. Didn't know what to do. And at the time, my instructor taught me how to do hard edge. And really what hard edge is, for anybody who doesn't know what the term means, is you use a combination of masking tape and acrylic paint. And with that, you can get these really nice, slick, clean edges. And the acrylic paint is important to use because it dries fast. If you were to use oil paint, you could technically try to do it, but oil paint takes a long time to dry. So and hard edge painting was developed about kind of the 50s and 60s. There were some artists that did it back then, but really it's not a super popular thing to do. And it's quite unique. It's getting more popular with murals and you'll see them a lot more, but it's really about having a really slick edge, really nice and sleek. And using masking tape as a tool. It's not thought of as a trick. It's used as a tool because it really can make really, really beautiful, beautiful crisp edges. So my instructor taught me that, and I practiced it. It does take some practice to really get it perfected. And I took about 3 years of just playing with the colors, learning how to mix paint, just all the things that you kind of need to know when you're starting out with painting. And one day my instructor said to me, he was a wonderful mentor. His name was Christopher Willard. And he is now over at AU Arts and the head of painting. And Christopher said to me, he asked, why was I still so interested in these lines? There was other students kind of going in different directions. And he's like, why are you still, you know, he taught me the technique, but it, you know, it was really, where did I want to take this? And he's like, well, can you tell me, Billie, why you're so interested in this? And it was a, you know, kind of a hypothetical question of like, just think about this for a little while. And I was like, okay. And that same week I was heading back to Yorkton from Calgary because my mom was really ill with cancer. And there's a lot of road trips. And if anybody's done that road trip, it's a long one. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of the prairie scene where as a passenger, you have a nap a few times if you can. And it's, I remember on the way back from visiting mom, my husband at the time was driving and I was just looking out the window, kind of snoozing almost, you know, just looking out. And I had an epiphany. It was just like people talk about where that light bulb moment happens. And I had the epiphany where I saw the landscape as these linear lines and these geometric shapes. It was, I think, because I was a little sleepy and I saw the clouds as these triangles and shapes. And the, when you're driving, that sort of sprawl that happens when you're going quite fast along the highway. And I saw it. And so that next art class, I had found just a calendar image of the prairies, like something random. And I started painting that in that next class. And my instructor almost fell over. He's like, that's what you're supposed to be doing. He's like, that's why you've been practicing this. And there's not very many of us who do abstract landscape like this. There's a lot of hard edge artists who will use that technique, but only a handful that actually put the two together, the landscape and the hard edge. So I've been doing it ever since. And that's back in 2007, I started those first paintings. Okay. And I feel like I still have a lot more to say. I still think there's a lot more I can use with the technique, scale, a lot more that I have that can be out there. So it really was an epiphany, Rob, where I didn't really know what my source was going to be. And I just saw it the one day and I can't get those visions out of my head.
Well, that's amazing. You know, like, well, art has that effect on you, which is really, I find fascinating, is that once sort of, I think Jordan Peterson was talking about this or something like that, but like once a certain art form takes root, you can't stop seeing that. Like, it never existed before. And then all of a sudden now all you see is those patterns, like Picasso's cubism. Yes. Or those kind of things, right? Like, now everyone can do that, or everyone knows what that is. It seems obvious. Or even impressionism.
Yes.
Before there was impressionism, like, nobody's painting, like, nobody saw the world that way, but now you can see the world that way. It just makes a lot of sense. And with you, like, again, you just, I mentioned to you, it's a simple, like, in terms of concept of what you're doing, putting tape down, mixing colors. Yeah. Painting up there, very basic. Anybody could actually do that technique.
Yes.
But to turn that into, and it's an abstraction, but to turn that into something vivid and moving.
Yeah.
And, well, I don't know, it's instantaneous, you know, exactly what that is, or at least you have a really good interpretation of what that is. But it's just these little hard edges, because that those hard edges don't exist in real life like that. Right. But
exactly.
You found a way to find those little hard edges and the straight lines, the triangles, you know, you know, I'm just looking at that painting behind me right now too. Like, it's a prairie sky. Like, I've yeah. seen that.
Even though you're never going to see them starting in and out like that in real life, it yeah. still gives you that feeling. And it's about, a lot of it's a choice of colors and how the colors influence each other. And that's where I still feel like there's so much that I can do, because just practicing and learning color theory is something that artists can spend their whole life doing.
Yeah. I tried to count the colors today in that painting. Individual colors, and I have at least 13, but there's probably more. Well, I'm pretty sure there are more, just with the subtle little changes that you do in the mixing yeah. of the colors, right? Just a little bit. Like, that's, again, that's just it's not a large painting. It's amazing how much effort you put into that too. And then now you're kind of moving beyond that, because it works really well where you live right now in Calgary. I have those silhouettes of those mountains, and I had a west facing when I was living in Calgary. When I was working as a geophysicist, I used to have this west-facing my window office, and I would see those mountains every morning, especially in the morning when the light was shining on them. Those bright, sunny mornings, right? And he always had that's Calgary to me. It's prairie, mountain, sky. That's what it is.
Exactly.
And so you have this technique now. It's absolutely perfect to capture that point of view. So I suppose that's some of the appeal people have of your work, living
I
in
think
Southern Alberta.
so. And anybody who's been out here in Calgary recently, the sunsets have been absolutely spectacular. So between the mountains, between the flat prairie, there's so much color that happens that I think people really start to get where my work is at. And I'll be honest, Rob, with any sort of artist, and I think it helps that I've also done this a little bit older. I'm 46. I'm not, the 20-year-old back in res. I also am fine if people don't like my work. Like if people don't get it, or they don't like it, or it isn't something that appeals to them, I'm okay with it. It doesn't feel like a personal rejection on me. I know that everybody has their own personal taste, but I am sometimes surprised that people who generally like something more realist or traditional will sometimes actually really like my work too, because they still see what I'm trying to get across. And or it might evoke a memory for them of a place they've been, or something that really, something about it will get it. So I have some collectors of mine that this is their first piece of abstracted
Right here, this guy,
painting.
right
Yay,
here.
yay, yay.
And you know, and we have this beautiful museum of modern art now in Saskatoon, the Remy Modern. And
Yes.
you know, I've been there, and some of the exhibits they have, I'm like, what the hell's going on here? And you don't want to be down on, but some stuff just like it looks ugly, and it just seems like they're trying to be abstract for the sake of being abstract, and they're not trying to find anything aesthetically pleasing at all. They're trying to make some sort of like political statement or whatever. I'm like, why can't you just make something beautiful? Like, it doesn't have to be any, it doesn't have to appear like a person or landscape or a pot of flowers, but can you find a way to make this art like move a little bit or sort of
I see what you
interesting,
mean.
you know? And it seems that art has kind of lost its purpose, modern art, you know? So, but when I see what you're doing, it's very, again, it's very abstract. These are just lines and triangles. That's all you're doing. But they speak to me like they move in my mind, and it's like, you know, I've seen that before, or you know, I can imagine myself in that spot, and it's just, again, lines and triangles, that's all you're doing. But you're putting it in such a way with the colors, especially the colors, right? I think the colors are kind of the key to everything there, right? We just the careful detail to have the contrast and colors. And I guess maybe the hard edge actually does that, yeah, like I said, it does a contrast a lot better because it's a hard edge and it allows you to make colors pop.
It does.
A lot
It
more,
does.
hey?
And it also helps you with having colors speak to each other, because sometimes
Right.
where you put it makes it interesting. And my process is really strange too, because I don't know what I want it to look like exactly in the end. I'll have an idea of what I'm going for. I'll figure out where I want the horizon line, where I want the land and sky to meet, what kind of mood I'm going for,
Okay.
but I won't know exactly what's happening. So even your piece that's sort of behind you, that it's got mainly a kind of canola type, or mustard field on the bottom with the vibrant sky with lots of clouds at the top. It probably took me several layers to develop exactly where I wanted to go. So I don't sketch out ahead of time. I
Oh,
don't use
really?
software. Yeah, I don't use software. And I do that for a couple purposes. It's because I like painting and I like problem solving. So a lot of my work will be about artist resolve. So I'll be painting and then I'll have to leave it for a bit just because it's not maybe not working. And how do I push through, and how do I have that perseverance to fix it and make it go a certain thing? And it might just be another little piece, like another line or something, or a fix of a color that it takes. And so I sometimes my works will take a month or longer to finish, just because I'm doing so many layers and I want to make sure that they're all interacting and talking to each other. And I like that element of surprise, where once I get it completed, I always make sure that I would put them up in my place. That's always my sort of standard, is would I want this? And when I know it's done is when I feel comfortable that I've resolved all the problems. Yeah,
Fair
so
enough.
it's very different. It takes me a long time though. I would probably be a lot more prolific if I could spit them out, but that's also not really the it would be like telling somebody who bakes to just use the package, the mix of baking, you know. No, they like going from scratch and
yeah, it'll work, but that's not the point. It's the process as much as anything else too. Exactly. It feels probably pretty good. Or well, tell me your feeling you have when you're creating this art then too, like just in sort of what kind of state do you get yourself into about creating this sort of thing, or how does it make you feel inside as you're expressing this sort of work?
I think the biggest thing being an artist and doing this type of work is being present. And that was, I'll tell you, the one of the number one reasons why I wanted to leave my good career that I had, because I had the pension, I had all the benefits, I had a great group of colleagues that I had developed over a decade, actually over 12 years, almost 13 years at SATE. But I wanted to, I found that I really was yearning, especially with the pandemic, to be present. And I was tired of the Zoom calls and the to-do lists and the, you know, 1,000 emails that happen in between those things. And I felt like I was just always doing things for other people. And it actually really caused a lot of stress. And I was on a medical leave last year at exactly this time. I was on a medical leave and I'd never had a mental health issue with my work before. And I found that when I was on leave, all I focused on was being present, you know, being with the kids, hearing them laugh, listen, you know, breathing, God forbid that we actually focus on your breath. Yeah. And painting was a big one, where all my job was when I'm painting is I'm making choices, I'm mixing color, I'm having courage, and I'm experimenting. Even if I'm listening to a podcast or music at the same time, I'm still present. I'm not thinking about what I'm making for supper that night. I'm not thinking about the other emails I need to take care of. My choices right at that moment are the only things that matter. And it's really, really amazing now to have that as being my focus. So some days when I get up and, you know, I have other things to do and I'm like, oh, I should get in the studio. I have to sometimes push myself because like anything, you always can get other distractions. But when I'm in there, it's back to that being present. And if I can get back into that state, I have a great day. Even if the work doesn't look like anything grand at the end of it, I have a great day. And it's been night and day for my mental health, like completely night and day.
That's such an interesting point. I've been thinking about this sort of thing lately too. Like I heard a story about like mountain climbers. Like I have no interest in climbing a mountain. Well, I climbed Mount Rundle.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And it's a long walk uphill. And I was tired. But anyways, I've climbed a mountain, but like those hardcore mountain climbers, right? But the point of what they're trying to do there, it's a challenge. That's part of it. Or that's a huge part of it. But it's also, I think it's the being present, because a mountain climber who isn't present
is a dead mountain climber.
You have to be forced to do that, right? And these people are like, what is my next hold? What is my path up? And everything should be focused on that, like that sort of safety, self-preservation, get you to the highest point. And that's so like it's a participatory act is what that is. So it's not the end of it all. And for you, it's again, once you're satisfied with it, you can move on. But really, it's the whole point is it's problem solving. It's figuring out this, what are you becoming and how are you going to sort of figure this stuff out? So you have to participate in that. And I also, like, you know, I listen to a lot of religious podcasts too, just because I find them, well, I listen to a lot of podcasts and stories. And these guys talk about the ritual in church. And it's like, you sit there, you can be sit there and bored if you want. And most people are, or you can participate in it and you go through the rituals. And you take it seriously and you kind of follow through the ritual. It's the participation which matters. And that way, you know, they believe like, you know, they're actually participating in real time with the events that occurred 2,000 years ago. They actually walk it through. There's a reason why these things existed for 2,000 years. And I think that's probably a good reason why a lot of art has existed. Solid, really beautiful art has existed in that long amount of time, because it's the act of doing it.
Absolutely.
Is it in and of itself?
Yeah, I agree. I totally understand what you're trying to say. And I think that's really key. There was a interesting, it was kind of like I guess it was, well, it was through here at Contemporary Calgary recently, which is one of the newer art galleries, and they did a Zoom call, but you could also go in person. And there is a doctor who, a scientist, who was talking about how really how our brain handles beauty and what we look at.
Oh,
and
cool.
And it was very, very interesting. I probably have to listen to about 5 times to grasp it all. There was so much in it. But the one of the simple things that he talked about is how when you're painting, so when you paint, you are creating your composite, your idea first. Like, what is your idea? Just like I told you, what kind of mood am I going after? Is it a, you know, is it a stormy night? Is it a sunset? Is it a, you know, sunny canola field? So you go with your idea, then you go with your composition, and then you go with your fine details. So that's how your painting progresses as an artist. But then as a viewer, it's the complete opposite. So as if you're looking at my painting right now, you're looking at the details, then you're looking at the composition, and then you might get to where was that artist's idea or where is your idea coming from. Not everybody gets to that last stage, depending on what kind of work it is. So the work at the Ramey Center that you saw, maybe you don't get to that. Like, maybe you're not there, and that's okay. And maybe also the artist intended for you not to really understand. But I found it super interesting how an artist goes through it chronologically that way as part of building a piece, but then the viewer sees it completely opposite. So there's so many different things, but also as a viewer, you have to be present to look at the detail, then look at the composition, and then try to figure out the idea. And most of us, if it doesn't attract us right away, we'll just keep walking. You know, if you're in a museum or a gallery space, you might just keep walking if those details don't interest you.
I wonder if that's an intuitive thing then too, is just sort of trust your intuition and select a piece that maybe speaks to you, and then you can focus on it. So maybe it just has to have enough to catch your eye that it's like, you know, I want this around here in my own home, and view it. Some, or whatever, or maybe want to come visit this museum again and again, just to study a little bit more. So where did this come from? Right. Maybe that's enough. Right. And there's so much art that's out there. So, right. So it's, everyone can find something that appeals to them. Yep. But I think of that way with musically, listen to a good album. You know what I mean? You have that album that you love, and then you listen to it like 1,000 times, and then you tell, hey, check out this album. And everyone's like, yeah, it's not that good. And, but for you, you've invested that time into it. So you heard here's the hook of the song, and here's the general theme of the song, and then maybe you understand the lyrics a bit better. And then for me, like, I love, because I'm a musician, I just love, like, think, oh, here's that little cymbal that I never heard before. And those are my favorite albums, ones that have all these different layers and built up. It's like, wow, where did this come from? And then I showed it to somebody else, and everyone's like, it's not that good, Rob. But that's what that is, right? That's me participating in the art in reverse, right?
Exactly. Just the way it absolutely is. And it's also you as a musician would respect and understand things different than somebody else who maybe just listens to pop music or just doesn't. And there's nothing wrong with either. And
nothing wrong with pop music.
Yeah. No. Well, I joke.
We're not snobs, people.
No, we're not snobs. But I always try to say, like when I told you earlier, that I don't get offended when people don't like my work, because not everybody likes Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
But then not everybody likes, say, somebody like a Casey Musgraves. I don't know. I'm just thinking of her, like from a, you know, country or Rush. I don't like Rush.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry if you like, some people love Rush.
Because they listen to it over and over and over again, and they realize how just amazing they are. Like, I'm not a Rush fan, but like, I get that. Yeah.
But so would, you know, what's the lead singer? Hedy Lee. Is that his name again?
Geddy Lee,
thank you. Would Geddy Lee be mad if somebody said, if I just said, I don't like Rush, would he like go and cry? No, he wouldn't.
No, he's a rich man with 100 million followers, and yeah, no, he's fine.
Exactly. So I think you have to be okay that you're not going to be for everybody. And that's what makes us all so unique, is that each of us like different things. So it's okay if you go to a gallery and you don't get the work, or you don't like it, or you might like it, but you don't want it in your house. That's also a totally other different thing. And people might like some of my work, but it's just not their aesthetic to put it up in their space. And that's
I don't see it, Billie. All your stuff is awesome. So Billie, you went out, you had an opportunity to go to the Banff Center. Well, a month ago or a little bit more now.
Yes. Yep.
What's a Banff Center, and why was that such a great experience for you? I'm just editorializing now. It was a great
Sounds
experience for
good.
you.
Yes. So the Banff Center, it's called the Banff Center for Arts and Creativity, and it is a campus. It's like a post-secondary, but it's a campus. Some of it is non-credit education that you get, but it is really set up for all types of the arts. So from theater to visual art, to music, like all those kind of areas, dance, all of those, they have the opportunities there. They were hit really hard by the pandemic. So the Banff Center's been around for quite a long time, many, many, many years, and it has changed. The campus is just if anybody knows Banff, it is on the way to Tennell Mountain, and it's a beautiful space that overlooks the town of Banff. And they were hit really hard by the pandemic, though. I won't get into the whole stuff of the Banff Center because I don't know all of the history, but they had to lay off 400 of their 600 staff.
Oh,
Yes, and they shut down completely. So they part of their business was to have some conferences in because that was also could also cover for the arts that were in there. And as many of us know, all theater was shut down, all dance. And it's a very internationally renowned space. So it isn't just people from Banff or Calgary or Alberta. It is international creatives come to that space. So they had to shut down and they were closed. The campus was closed for a year and a half. The only people really on campus were the maintenance people and security and kind of keeping things going. So I had actually applied. They have very, because it's an education space, but in a unique way, you could apply to have a residency. And the residency, you can do two different types. One is a one where it's you've got mentors, so you might have other artists or some faculty that will work with you. Or you can do a self-directed one where it's just you and you've got your own kind of plans and go there. So I had applied in 2019 for a self-directed one. And that meant that I could do what I wanted for, I applied for 2 weeks. You can apply it for 5 weeks. And I wanted to, for 2 weeks, just have the opportunity to paint in a space out at the Banff Center. I was accepted. However, my time that I was supposed to go out was May 2020. That did not happen because of COVID. We were just coming out of
Yeah,
lockdown.
good
Then
timing.
it got, yeah, it got rescheduled to that winter. No, because Jason Kenney still had us back in somewhat lockdown out here in Alberta. And so I got an email this past summer and they were going up campus and asked me if I wanted to be one of the first persons back. However, campus was still technically closed. And it would be only a handful of us there, and we would still have food services, and we could still stay in their hotel as the residents, but there would be very few people there. And I said, absolutely. My goal was to have 2 weeks where I had no mommy responsibilities. I'm the mother to two absolutely amazing daughters, a 12-year-old and a 9-year-old, but that takes up a lot of time being a mom. And I was keen to be an artist for 2 weeks. So that was the whole goal, is to go there for that time period, just focus on painting and not have other distractions like laundry and regular adulting to have to worry about. So I said yes, and when I got there, it was fantastic. It was the beginning of October, and the studio space was actually in the woods. So the picture behind me right now is in that studio, and it had a bathroom in it. It was out in the woods. There's I think about six different places altogether where composers or writers could go. My studio was the biggest one. It was one of the visual arts ones, and you didn't sleep in it, but you had 24-hour access to it if you wanted. And it's about a 3 to 5 minute walk from the main campus. So you actually go through the woods and you're there. And there was like three deer that lived in the little hood that we were in. And there was probably in total, Rob, I'm not joking, probably 15 people on all of campus during that time, plus the staff. So they did still have meals for us. So there was staff there that would serve us 3 meals a day. But otherwise, it was super secluded. It was Awesome. I'd have to get security to walk me home at night, though, once it got dark, because it was so quiet, I kind of had the heebie-jeebies on that a little bit. But it was perfect because I had no other distractions. It was just what I wanted to get done. I did befriend another lady that was there, but otherwise, I spent most of the time in the studio. Some days I was in there over 12 hours just painting. And I think it showed to me that I can focus my time and not feel burnt out from doing that, and that I do have that creativity in me, and it isn't finite, it is as infinite as I want it to be. So that was really inspiring for me, and it felt good to just feel like my only need was I had to go to pick up the food or go eat during the little windows they gave us. That was the only to-do item I had to do for 2 weeks.
Honestly, it might have been even better because I've been there before. My wife worked there for a few months, 2008, 2000, late 2008, early 2009. And it's a very special, beautiful place. Like, it's world-class facility for the arts. And but there's a lot of stuff going on there too, right? There's always like shows, and there's always something to be had. And so if you're there, you could get distracted by, well, I gotta paint, but also so-and-so is playing a concert here tonight. You had nothing going on there but just time to work. So that is pretty cool. One cool thing for you too, I remember, was that the northern lights were quite vivid. Just happened to be vivid when you're almost like it was a sign or something
Totally.
for
So my
you.
subject, I had known what I was going to go in and focus on. I had already put in my proposal that I wanted to work on a series of the Northern Lights. Since 2007, I've only ever created two pieces based on the Northern Lights. So I knew it was a subject matter I wanted to really look at. And I have an exhibition next fall about the Northern Lights at an art gallery out here called the Leighton Art Center, just outside of Calgary.
Oh,
And I have
cool.
a solo show coming up then. So I knew this would be a chance for me to start building some work for that show. But yeah, exactly. I have not seen the Northern Lights in person probably for at least since I was a teenager. And I used to see them a lot in Saskatchewan. That's, something very common, especially in the community where I was. It was farming area, so there was a lot of spots you could see it. But I hadn't been out at, midnight or 2 in the morning purposefully to look for the Northern Lights. So it was very serendipitous because I was working on this series. I follow these apps, and I'm on a couple Facebook groups about the Aurora, just because as part of my research for this project.
Oh, that is really cool. Sorry, go ahead.
And
That's really cool.
yeah, there's one. If anybody, no, but honestly, Rob, if somebody's interested and they live in Alberta, there's some in Saskatchewan too, but there's one called Alberta Aurora Chasers. It's a Facebook group, and there's almost 100,000 members in it. 100,000. I'm not making this up. It's crazy. So there's a lot of them are photographers and people that are interested. So I've been following these apps, and it said it was going to be quite potentially maybe like high numbers, but there's never a guarantee ever because
Oh.
it's how the particles react and all these things. So
It could
but
be cloudy
because
and all this other stuff, right? So,
yes, it can be cloudy. And I had been watching the app, and I said to this other artist that I met there, her name was Judith, and I said, you know what, I think I'm gonna go out to Lake Minnewanka, which is about a 20-minute, 15-20-minute drive from Banff. I think I'm gonna go out there tonight and see what I can see. Because the reality also is I can't normally just decide to go out on a Tuesday night, which that was, and just head out for, a handful of hours. Usually the kids are here. So I'm not just going to be like, hey, I'm heading out at 9 p.m. and I
on a
might be
whim,
back at 3
right?
in the morning. Yeah, it's just not part of my lifestyle. I can't do that right now. So, but there I could. So I was like, you know what? I have my boots. I'm going to bring some snacks and a water bottle and my toque, and I'm going to go to Lake Minnewanka. And I was such a rookie because I was like, you know what? I'm going to text you, Judith, and let you know when I get there in case nobody's there. Well, I show up and there's like dozens of cars.
Right.
And if anybody's seen the end of the amazing movie Field of Dreams, at the end of the movie Field of Dreams, there's just like a stream of cars that are coming to their field. Wow. That's kind of what it looked like at Lake Minnewanka, of just like headlights coming through like for hours on end. And
wow.
The great thing is I saw them. My camera isn't the greatest. My phone camera wasn't, but that wasn't my purpose. I wasn't there to take photos. I was there to experience it again. And I put my phone away and just watched. So I saw them at around, I think around 10 o'clock. And then I stayed, and about 12:30 again, they came out again, really, really vibrant. And just the dancing, just what you would think. And I stayed out till about two. I was only about four or five cars left when I left at two. It was amazing. And just again, that serendipity. So you can't, I was supposed to be there at that time. That's all I can say. I'm not that kind of, usually I'm not a woo-woo person like that, but everything was meant to be where I was able to be there. There was the clouds, and it was a spectacular night. People in Calgary could even see it from the city. So
yeah,
it was gorgeous. Well, all over Canada. It wasn't just out here. It was Saskatchewan, out to Ontario. It was a beautiful night. That was a gorgeous night.
That was so, well, it's weird though that, again, you were doing some research on this, and then, it just happens to be the one time you're there.
And it happened to be out till 2
without any responsibilities whatsoever that it occurred.
I might need to be pursuing more Northern Lights images. I think it's kind of, I don't know if the universe can give me more of a sign.
Well, for sure. But like, again, it really exposed you to different colors and color schemes. Like looking behind you on your wallpaper there, like the vibrant greens and yellows and the glow. And that's so much different than, say, the bright, sunny sky or a sunset, right? Like those are different colors. Those are from a different world almost, you know, that's what it looks like. But you still know exactly what that is. Like he's like, well, those are. That looks like a northern landscape right there. Like that's so amazing that you're able to investigate these new colors and schemes together.
And that's my whole goal. You can see in the work behind here, there's like pieces of tape, and these were just while they were still in the works, but they're still not completed. When I came back from Banff, I put them aside for a little while, because also 2 weeks looking at the same pieces for hours on end is a lot, but it is a chance for me to try to figure out new ways to interpret it. And there also isn't a ton of artists who have done paintings of the Northern Lights. There are quadrillion a million photographers who are shooting the Northern Lights, but there really isn't a ton of painters who are using them as an idea. So this is a great chance for me to test out some new ideas.
Yeah, no, that's,
and it makes it more exciting too. I'm not doing the same landscapes that I normally do. It's giving me a bit of a challenge, and that's always good.
Yeah, for sure. It just opens up a whole new world for you as well too, and I think that's really cool. I want to talk really briefly, if you have some time here still. You had some nice commission opportunities too. Commissioned some for some public works, right? I know when I was in Calgary, I saw there's these street barricades that the city had commissioned some of the local artists to do some nice design work on it. And you're one of the artists that they selected.
Yes. That was one of my first mural projects, which is cool to have a public art like that. And the structure is unique. It's the Jersey barriers that you see everywhere on construction. But there was a handful of us artists that we were asked to paint those. And I had five front, back, and sides that I did. Each had a different design. And those, why they chose to do that as part of the mural project this year, is because the patios were all extended onto sidewalks because of the pandemic, a lot of, you know, social distancing, and also to give more opportunities for businesses to have more capacity. They had cut off some of the road sections and had more pedestrian areas and more patio space. So to keep it safe, they needed to put these barricades up anyway. And they're ugly as heck if they're just concrete or those other safety ones that are just bright orange. So their idea was, this is a great way to have some safety, support businesses during the pandemic, but also get some local artists involved. So it was tons of fun. other than my body was sore after kneeling down for 2 weeks trying to paint these, trying to paint these 3 foot high concrete barriers. But that just shows my age more than anything.
I don't think you were probably obsessing over the small and minute details and making numerous changes with those. I think you were just like, okay, let's make it beautiful and done.
I did take a little bit longer than some of my colleagues because I was kind of experimenting a little bit, but it was really good for me to change that because with murals, you need to know what you want your end product to somewhat look like. And that is something that I've learned if I'm going to do more murals in the future, it just switches the way that my process will be thought out. That's okay. So that was one of my big commissions this year. One of the biggest ones that I've had was I did one for State, which was great in 2014. I did a large banner on their heritage hall, which was a commission for them. But then around that time in around 2015, 16, I did a commission for Foreign Affairs Canada. And it was using some of my images. One was actually a Northern Lights image, some paintings that I created, and they were then redesigned into large scale hand tufted carpets. And these carpets were put in Canada House, which is the embassy in London, England. And Canada House is located right on Trafalgar Square. And they were renovating because they were just moving into that space from a different location. And they were renovating the whole area and wanted all Canadian artists and Canadian furniture designer, you know, the whole Canadian made everything. Mm-hmm. And so they actually contacted me and asked me to submit designs, which I still to this day have no idea where they heard about me. Wow. But they asked me to submit designs and I had two of them that were decided on. So one is a Chinook type painting, almost kind of similar color palette to what's in the painting you have, Rob. Mm-hmm. And that was recreated into a carpet for the Alberta meeting room. So there's meeting rooms in this large massive space about each province and territory. And then the largest one I have is the Northern Lights one. And it was two carpets they made. They're the carpets themselves, so not what I got paid, but what the carpets cost around 20 to 30 grand each to get made.
Right.
And they're massive. And I have photos of the Queen on it. And I also have when Justin Trudeau did his first press conference in London and his first, when he was newly elected, that was his press conference was on that carpet. So that was that was kind of one of those highlight pivots for me, where this was an international opportunity. This was recognized by the Canadian government, and they're still there. And I was able to go see them in person a handful of years ago too.
Oh, that's so
cool. So that was great. That was actually really big for me personally, just to go, okay, people like this, you know, and also I never would have thought in a million years that I would have artwork on a carpet. Like that just wasn't anything ever in my thought process. Right. So to see how those could be recreated onto a massive carpet space was really, really cool.
Yeah, it's interesting how somebody had that concept, right? Because it's like, well, we need some carpet space. Well, it's got to be Canadian. Yeah. Well, can we get a Canadian artist? And what kind of art would actually look good? Like, could we actually reproduce it on a carpet?
Yeah.
And would look like it fit in as a functional thing, but also it was a work of art in and of itself. And so then they put, you know, this person here has some pretty neat stuff. Again, hard edges, but it actually works really well with textile. So
it was, it was really great for them because they could color match it quite easily, and they could also have the shapes work really well. And it was massive. So the ones that I have up in, it's called the Laurier Room, and it overlooks Trafalgar Square. And they're gigantic.
Holy cow. So it was a Canadian company, I guess, that manufactured that you would have worked with them, or you just sent them your
I just sent them the file. Yeah, it went right
to Foreign Affairs. Okay.
Yeah, I sent them, it was a high-res image of the painting. The original painting for that Northern Lights one that's in Laurier Room is only 30 inches by 40 inches, and it's in my bedroom. I've kept that one. Mm-hmm. I've kept that piece. And so I had a high resolution photo created of that painting, and and then they digitized it and created it. And it's a company in Toronto called Creative Matters, and they specialize in rug design, so custom rug design and high end, but it's all hand tufted, and that's where the expense come in. And from what I, when I got a tour of Canada House, they said it, they have cleaners that just come in just for the rugs, like bi-weekly. So
yeah, they want to protect that.
Sure. They take their, and they consider it part of the art collection. They don't just consider it as decor. They considered it as part of the art collection too.
Well, you know, just thinking again too, just bringing those, like bringing art as part of the function of a space too, is also something that I think we've lost as a society here. We just take art, we hang it on walls, and that's fine. But like, just I always tell people about him because he's awesome. But it's that Orthodox icon carver, Jonathan Pageau. I watch a lot of his YouTube videos, and he carves icons. Like, who carves icons? Like, he's Greek Orthodox. He's French Canadian. Like, so how do you become an Orthodox person? So, but he's really big into symbolism. But he talks about like how spaces were actually used, and like modern, like even churches, like they don't look. Yep. They're kind of, well, look at my room. It's beige, and you know, it's kind of safe, kind of colors that people want to have, and stuff that's warm. But he's like, he says, Shark Cathedral was painted. It used to be covered in just beautiful art. And these old castles in movies, you see these old castles, they all look dark and gray. He's like, no, they're covered in gold and silver and reds and purples. Like, these guys love, in medieval times, they loved art. He actually even mentioned how Montreal Cathedral, is it Cathedral Montreal or is it a name for it? I forget what it is.
Yes. Isn't it the Notre Dame? No, that's the one in... That's the other one. No, I know which one you're talking about, though.
Montreal, right? But now they have all these beautiful lights in there now. They're all set up, and you do tours, and they have these interior lights. He's like, that's where churches should be, or like, not just churches, but public spaces should be lit up and express some sort of pattern or a beauty or meaning of some sort in there. So that's a proper way to do that. And so I like the idea of our ambitions. Like, I bitch about government spending all the time, but like, I like the idea of actually jersey barriers. Let's make it pretty. Like, there's nothing like, what does it cost us to do that? And just, it sort of brightens up the city just a little bit more. It would have been there otherwise, you know. And like, I know, like, people complain about the big giant circle on.
I'll tell you, I didn't get paid giant circle money. Like, you know, they're being very fiscally responsible.
Yeah. One, I think they just like, some idiot just said, let's just pick something, rather than finding something that kind of fits the space and provides some purpose. Like, I like going under, Glenmore and McLeod, you know, and they have those fish that are jumping up on the walls, and it's. Yeah. It's something that enlivens the space. And so I really love the fact that you've been able to participate in that on a couple times too. And I think really, you know, just given your experience with that, maybe you can get some more commissions and maybe you'll have a bit more time. This might be a good segue.
Yeah. Well, that's the biggest thing from me taking this on as a full-time entrepreneur and doing this is, the few opportunities that I've been able to have over the last year, if I was working full time, I would have had to say no to. I maybe would have had holidays banked up, but my holidays are for my kids. That's for when I want to spend with them. So two quick examples from this last year is those jersey barriers, which was through the Beltline Urban Mural Project. It's a very popular project out here in Calgary. And it took me 2 weeks, like full 2 weeks, to paint those five barriers. So and also it was May, so there was a couple of days where it rained. So could you imagine if I was working full time, if I was trying to take days off, but I didn't know if it was going to rain or not, like it wouldn't, I wouldn't have been able to do it in my free time in the evenings or weekends. So I would have had to say no to that and I would have lost that opportunity. And then also same thing with the BAM Center, to take 2 weeks off. Generally you need to plan ahead, and right there that would have been 4 weeks, which it probably would have been most of my holiday time. So I would have had to say no to these opportunities if I was still in that job opportunity or in that job career. So these are things that I remind myself when maybe it's, you know, not the every 2 week paycheck coming in, and some of those adjustments as an art entrepreneur, and how do you keep your business thriving, not just getting by, but how do you thrive in it? I remind myself, though, these opportunities wouldn't have happened if I was still trying to juggle both. And really, I had chose to do this not so much for the business side, but more for the mental health side, that my other job just wasn't working well for me. And then now I'm finding that all those skills over that career that I told you about, with marketing and communications and projects, like working in sports is all projects. It's, you know, okay, we got 8 games this weekend. Okay, how are we going to get this done? Playoffs start. We don't know if we're in playoffs until we win on Sunday. You know, like there's, everything is deadlines and projects. And so all those skills that I've learned over 20 years in sports and advertising and comms and sales, I've been able to thankfully put over into my art business.
That's good. So that, and yeah, I was going to say, this is a good opportunity to segue into, if people want to support your work that you're doing or are interested in your work, what's a good way to get started? I know I follow you on Facebook. That's one place to do that.
Yeah. Instagram is another big one too. So the Instagram, I'm actually probably more on there. I probably post almost every day just because it's much easier to be more visual on Instagram. And that is, you can look up my name, Billie Rae Busby, on there, but it's, the account is at BR_Busby.
Okay.
And then on Facebook, Art by Billie Rae Busby is my one on there. And for spelling, if anybody's listening on the podcast, it's Billy is BILLIE. And the middle name is RAE and last name is BUSBY.
Yeah, I'll put some links in the description for sure.
There's my website. My website is also another great way that they can check out my work from years past, and also some of those commissions that we talked about, the bump commissions of the Jersey Barriers and the ones in London are on there, so they can take a look at those. But I'd say Instagram's probably a good start. You can kind of see what I'm up to, how my process is done, what I've got available. And I do sell my work through my website, but I also do have some galleries that I'm working with too, and that information is on the website.
Yeah, and I signed up to your mailing list too, and I thought that was actually kind of a cool thing, because that's when this painting popped up. I was like, oh good, I just go, and it was just real easy. I just clicked in there, put it down, and I bought it. And I was like, yes, I got it. And I was like, because there was one before, you had a sale before, some other works of art. And I was like, I want that. Oh, let's go. I want that one. I was like, oh, okay, just be patient. More will come up, and it did. Yes. I was like, I'm going to grab that one. So I got it, and I was pretty
glad you did.
So people, if you're interested in Billie's work, yeah, definitely sign up to her mailing list. You don't annoy us. I find that you just send out the occasional information update, and then when you have sales or selling some of your work, that's when it comes up. And so I think you're going to have some pretty neat work. Some of those work here, I take you're going to take on display in some galleries too, because that's a big part of the art, right? It's part of marketing yourself, right? Is to have work in galleries. I take it too, is it not? Like it gets in front of people that are art lovers.
For sure. And that's something that's really fun about being an art entrepreneur right now, is you can sell on your own. So a lot of my art friends do just sell through their social media and their website on their own. And I'm trying to work on a bit of a hybrid where I do sell on my own. I've built a wonderful, I guess, community of people I've known through my business contacts and just friends and things that I, you know, somebody who's like, oh, you should see my friend Billie Rae's work, or, you know, like there's all that. So I like the ability to sell directly to people, and I like that relationship with clients. But I do have a couple galleries that I'm starting to work with, and I'm going to be, I haven't even announced on my social, so you're getting the exclusive here, Rob. I'm going to be working with a gallery in Montreal soon. They're going to have representing some of my pieces soon, and we're going to test that out for a different market. So that's also the fun part, is with galleries, that's a different business model and more of a, and those are commercial galleries. There's also public galleries that you can get into for exhibitions, but I do like having my work out there for other people to see that I don't know that might go in there. But if anybody is just interested in checking out most of my work that is on either my Instagram or my website, or they can contact me. And they can DM me. I'm okay with that sort of thing. Yeah. And I do take commissions. I don't do very often. I've got a bit of a wait list, but if somebody likes my work and there's not something available, I sometimes do take clients who I can create a custom piece for. That's a bit of a different process, but right. that is something that I've done and I'm open to if people are willing.
Or if a client has $20,000-$30,000 and wants to make a really yeah. great carpet or
rug. Yeah, then I'm count me in and I'll also throw in a jersey barrier too. Just
kidding. Well, you never know who's listening here, and I think it's a good idea. I know a few rich
guys. Yeah, well, and it's also as we talked about earlier, it's people I think are especially over the pandemic, they're respecting that this is what I do now. Like this is my business, and people want to buy things where they know it's from, whether it's a sweatshirt. People are more, you know, they want to know, is it sustainable? Like not everybody does. But people are a little bit more interested. Where was this made? You know, like there's a lot of interest in that. You know, is this the only one? I generally don't do a lot of reprints.
Right.
That's not something I've gotten into because my clients like original work. They like knowing that that's the only one out there. So the piece that you have, that's the only one that exists. It's yours.
All mine.
So doesn't it make you feel kind of unique and part of that adulting growing up of having something that's just yours and special? So there's something about owning original art that I think can be really interesting. And I don't think it needs to be intimidating. You just go with what you like. And most artists are pretty open to having conversations. So, you know, if anybody had questions of how does it work to commission me, just email me or send me a message and I'm happy to chat with them.
Yeah, definitely. I recommend it. And I could attest to your quality of character too. Maybe some people like that. Although I don't know. You know, some people like the crazy artist too, but no, you're good. You can be a bit crazy, but.
That's old me. That's a long time ago, Rob.
Yeah.
But I do find that for sure. There is that stigma of I did have
bango and stuff, right?
With like, being burnt out at work. So does that count as?
Yeah. I have the same thing. I'm right with you.
Yeah. So there's, I think people can relate to that more than anything.
Yeah.
But I probably am a little bit more of a practical artist compared to some of my peers out there. But I also, it's similar back to comparing to musicians. You're going to find a little bit of everybody. And I also don't want that to hold me back from thinking that I need to be something. That's also what I've learned over the pandemic of being opened up to a whole world of artists through Zoom. I'm in a few memberships where I get to chat with other artists around the world. And it's been awesome because I realized that everybody's got their own voice. Everybody's got their own thing. Everybody's got, you know, different financial or family situations. And the one thing we have in common is that we like being creative. So, you know, there's always going to be a patron for somebody who is in there. And I'm a big advocate for supporting my friends. So if somebody doesn't like my particular style, but they're looking for something different, I'm very happy to point them over to some other people I know who are doing really fantastic work that might be a better fit for them.
That's good to know, Billy. Yeah, for sure. And I think that's just wonderful. We need more people like you out there doing this kind of wonderful work, creating a little beauty in our lives and sharing this sort of creativity and the process of making this work too. And I think it's very important what you're doing. And I'm very happy that you're doing this right now. I just wish nothing but the best for you here. I think you deserve it. And I'm looking forward to seeing all the wonderful work that you're going to produce here. Here and out. So everybody have a chance. Yeah. Just get in touch with her or just let me know. I'll get you in touch and you can find something really nice potentially that to make your space a little more, I don't know, just a piece of the prairies inside your home.
Exactly.
Well, I guess I'll let you go. So thanks a lot. And I guess we'll shut her down right now.